This is a so-called marine telescope. This is a day-night scope. And straight away, you can see it's got some features in keeping with the instrument we were looking at earlier on, only obviously on a much grander and larger scale. Now, this particular one we're looking at here has got the manufacturer's name on it, which I believe this is Dixie of London, and you see it's got written on here in rather quaint writing, improved portable day or night. Now, what is it they're really referring to here? Well, this important development in the portable telescope stems from John Dollond's patent of the achromatic lens set. So this is a two-element lens that counters the problems of chromatic aberration by offsetting the chromatic error of one lens by combining it with the performance of another lens, normally a crown and flint doublet set. In fact, we're going to look at one of those in just a second. We've got a lot of features that we recognise from the previous telescope, but the really big thing is the big lens. And that's really how come they can market this telescope as a night use or poor lighting. You can obviously appreciate with the telescope we were looking at earlier on, not with the best will in the world, could they really market that as a poor light telescope. So this was only really of any use during the day. Now the day and night telescope we've got here is a very different kind of animal. You can see straight away it's a very substantial looking instrument. One of the interesting things about it, we've still got the wooden tube. This isn't laminate. You can always tell when it's not. This one's obviously had some repair work done to it, but again, the use of these rivets on here in how the thing has actually been put together is usually a good indicator that you've got a genuine solid wooden tube here. We've got a sliding dew shield on this telescope, as well as a big guillotine at the front end. Now I'm going to just take this apart and show you an important feature of this telescope. I'm going to unscrew the front lens cell here. Again, the engineering is very pleasing on this instrument. Just slide that back. In fact, I want to just take that off. Actually, I'll take it off from that end. There's the lens cell. You can see that that's been hidden from view, and the lacquer is still in very good condition on this lens cell. Let's just put the instrument out of the way just for a moment and just show you this in a bit more detail. Can you see straight away we've got a similar thing going on here? They're still using the idea of a restricted aperture to minimize the effect of spherical aberration. So this is a defect in the lens where all the light is not coming to the same focus, largely because of the shaping of the glass this time, rather than merely the glass as a refractive medium that is separating the light into its different colours and stopping that. That's chromatic aberration. So they're still using this idea of the reduced aperture to try to improve the quality of the telescope. This has been really very, very nicely done. Let's just have a look at the eyepiece end on this very characteristic marine telescope. I'm just going to unscrew the barrel link here. This has got a multi-part construction. You can see there's actually about five parts making up that just that end piece there. I'll just take the cap off. And you can see we've actually got a nested tube here. Always like the way they've done a little cutout here so that you can just get your fingernail in there and just draw this nested tube eyepiece out. We've got a very large field lens here. And this is the that technique I was telling you about earlier on. You can see that the way this lens has been put into here, there's no retainer on it at all. The lens has actually been put in, and this very finely turned tip to this brass end plate has just been rolled over with a piece of hard wood while they've actually spun it up with the lens inside there. It really is very, very nicely done. This is very typical of this type of nested eyepiece tube that you would find on this type of instrument. And if I take the field lens out, you can see that exactly the same technique has been used. There's no retainer on there at all. That lens is permanently kind of encapsulated in that brass ring. And we can see the field stop inside there. Now at the other end of this tube, the very first drawer, we've got the Sherrill relay system, and I can show you that by separating this instrument just here. Now a little signifier again of the age of this instrument is the positioning of this thread on the coupling. On later instruments, we will actually see this thread move down to the other end of the coupling to provide more support. In fact, it was the telescopes of John Dollond where this is actually going to appear first. But if I close this up, we can see the relay lens there at the end of the tube. Now, this is an instrument purporting to be a Dollond achromatic refractor in the same style. You can see we've got the same wooden tube here. And if I pull the draw tube out a little way, this telescope's got some problems with it, but we can actually see there the name of Dollond London Day Night. Now, you could be forgiven for thinking that's an important way of identifying this type of telescope by its maker. But if we look carefully, we can actually see that Mr. Dollond's name is spelt incorrectly, and that instead of an O there, we've got an A. So instead of Dollond, we've got Dollond. Now, I did a quick check on eBay and one or two other auction sites and had a look for Dollond marine refractors. I found 17. And to be honest, I only think about three of them at best were genuine Dollond, either John or Peter Dollond refractors. So this is another important point of scepticism about the dating of instruments. It can actually be quite difficult and even very, very difficult to identify the maker. It's probably important to realise that a lot of the time, I'll just show you another one of these Dollond instruments again. We've got another one here with the Dollond name on it. And again, it's spelled incorrectly. We've got an A there instead of an O. Dollond really became synonymous with this type of instrument, and his reputation all the way into the later part of the 19th century was very, very high, to the extent that the Dollond really became the brand name of this type of telescope. So people would actually talk about a Dollond rather than a telescope. So not too surprisingly, especially as he really held something of a stranglehold on the design of the achromatic lens, really pursued quite tenaciously by his son Peter. Not too surprisingly, if you were going to make one of these telescopes, it was probably a pretty good idea to put the Dollond moniker on it in some form or another. So you need to be a bit sceptical when you see the name of Dollond on the telescope, because everyone just thought that was a really good idea, putting their name on it. Nobody has really got any pedigree in optics unless they've got loads of stuff in OXO tins. Here's an eyepiece from an instrument very like the wooden model from about 1750 we're looking at, and it's the eyepiece end of things. So this would have had multiple tubes on here. And once again, you can see the name of Dollond on here rather than Dollond. In fact, interestingly, this instrument maker has also put the rest of his details and name on here. A pretty risky thing to do, I would have thought, if the Dollond family actually got hold of this. But that's a very good example of finding two instrument makers' name on the same barrel.